I get my goofiness out. Good morning. Oh, Merry Christmas to everyone in the church. And those of you wherever in the world that you're at, welcome. Worship with us here on this Christmas Eve in Northeast Louisiana. Wherever in the world you're at, we just hope you and yours have a wonderful, wonderful, blessed Merry Christmas. Do you love the Lord?
Amen.
It is such a privilege to be able to come into His house. And it's a blessing and an honor to be able to come in the Lord's house at any time. There's something special about when the calendar falls, like last year, Christmas Day was on Sunday morning, and we had a wonderful service. And Christmas Eve, I know a lot of churches don't have service on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day if the day does fall on Sunday, but I think it's a special day.
Amen.
A special day that we are getting close to celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for all coming this morning and being faithful to the house of the Lord. Let us pray. Father, we love you. Father, we thank you on this Christmas Eve morning, Lord, for the greatest gift that you've ever given man, the gift of thy Son, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, your love for your creation. Lord, we thank you that you have given us your word for life and living. Lord, we thank you that you have given us thy spirit as the teacher, the real preacher, the illumination and the guide of our life, O God. And at this very moment, we invite the Holy Spirit to come. Lord, to take over this service as we celebrate the birth of thy Son, Jesus. Father, we thank you, giving you praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name, and everyone said amen,
amen.
And amen. Come on, praise team. Am I getting fired? Let me preach and then fire me.
The church wants to give you a gift for your service with us and bring forth a message to us every Sunday. And whatever you feel to do, you know, and we're proud to have you for our pastor.
Amen.
Noel, Noel, come
Son of God and Son of Man. There before the world began. Born to suffer, born to save. Born to raise us from the grave. Christ the everlasting Lord, He shall reign forevermore. No.
Story of amazing love, the light of
taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you, you shall find the baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And the shepherds returned after seeing Jesus, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was shown and told unto them.
For my mama, please.
This Christmas Eve, and these shoes are just her size. Could you hurry, sir? Daddy says there's not much time. You see, she's been sick for quite a while, and I know these shoes will make her smile, and I want her to look beautiful. Your mama meets Jesus tonight. Counted pennies for what seemed like years. Then the cashier said, son, there's none up here. He searched his pockets frantically. Then he turned and he looked at me. He said, Mama made Christmas good at our house, though most years she just did without. Tell me, sir, what am I gonna do? Somehow I've got to buy her these Christmas shoes. So I laid the money down. I just had to help him out. And I'll never forget the look on his face when he said, Mama's gonna look so great. Sir, I wanna buy these shoes for my mama, please. It's Christmas Eve and these shoes are just her size. Could you hurry, sir? Daddy says there's not much time. You see, she's been sick for quite a while, and I know these shoes will make her smile, and I want her to look beautiful. If Mama meets Jesus tonight. I knew I caught a glimpse of heaven's love as he thanked me and ran out. I knew God had sent that little boy to remind me what Christmas is all about. Could you hurry, sir? Daddy says there's not much time. You see, she's been sitting for quite a while, and I know these shoes will make her smile, and I want her to look beautiful. Your mama meets Jesus tonight. I want her to look beautiful. If Mama meets Jesus tonight. Happy birthday, Mama.
Oh, give the Lord a hand clap of praise.
Thank you, Henry. I know that was hard. Today was her and Charlie's mom's birthday, so. She sang that for her.
Thank you, praise team.
Really, you probably can turn me back down.
You have your Bibles. Keep your seat. We're going to read a few verses. I hope I don't plan on holding you long. Chapter of Luke, or Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, beginning at the very 25th verse. Gospel according to Luke, chapter 2, verse 25. We're going to talk about Simeon this morning, as well as Anna, the prophetess. Played Simeon in a Christmas play many years ago at Clark Springs Baptist Church, and if I may say so, I did a terrible job, and the real Simeon did a much better job, I'm sure. Luke chapter 2, beginning at the 25th verse. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Spirit that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents, Joseph and Mary, brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now let thou thy servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles in the glory of your people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. And Simeon blessed them and said unto Mary his mother, behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign which shall be spoken against. Yes, a sword shall pierce through your own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. And there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age and had lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And she, coming in that instant, gave thanks likewise unto the Lord, and spoke of him to all them who looked for redemption in Jerusalem. And I want to use for a subject this morning, preaching a few minutes. Christmas at the cross. Christmas at the cross. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, again. Lord, for this special eve, where we celebrate the birth of thy son, Jesus. Father, we thank you. We ask again for the Holy Spirit to come, to take thy word and to plant it deeply within the spirit of every heart here and those who are watching, oh God. And may you always receive all glory, praise, and honor. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Christmas at the cross. I mentioned last week about my business trip that some that I witnessed in a particular restaurant seemed like they had heavy hearts, heavy burdens. And in watching certain shows and hearing stories throughout the news media, there is a burden at this time of year for so many, that they will see the festivities and the lights and the movement of mankind, where they tell us, and I hope this to be true, but I have a feeling it's not, that one-third of this world claims to be Christian. And so it is the most celebrated holiday in the world. And I thank God for at least those that claim to be Christian. But there's much more to being a Christian than just claiming it. So,
amen.
I was praying this week, Lord, what would you have me say on the eve of your birthday? You see, church, we can get caught up in the trappings. The Bible even speaks about the trappings of Christianity. The Apostle Paul talked about this. That they have a sign of godliness, a perfume, if you will, an aura of Christianity. They may say the right things, thinking about the stockings. Stockings that some of us put over fireplaces or on a wall or hang on the tree. And if we're not careful throughout the year, and even on this time of year, you and I can be so concerned about filling all the stockings out there that all of a sudden we look up and our stocking's empty. Ours. In other words, we're concerned with the world. We're concerned with job, family, and all these other things, yes, which are necessary. Yes, they're a part of life. But at times, do you feel drained? You get tired. That's why Jesus said, those that are heavy laden, burdened and heavy laden, come unto me and I will give you rest. Come unto me, I will give you rest. Because if we're not careful, we'll get up and we'll look in our stocking and it's bone dry. What are you talking about, preacher? I'm not talking about carnal things. I'm not talking about how much money you got in your wallet or how many assets you own or don't own. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about spiritually. In other words, then, if we're not careful, we're just going through the motions, trying to get through day by day by day on our own strength and our own power. Church, that will drain you quicker than an appliance turned on and never shut off. You will burn out. And all of a sudden, it's going to be empty. And there's a reason why. You know why you can be empty? I'll tell you why. Because you're so worried about other stockings that you forget whose birthday it is.
Amen.
It's his stocking we should be concerned about. Not yours, not mine. His stocking. It's his birthday that we're celebrating. And the reason why our stocking, if you will, can get drained and depleted is because our eye is not on the prize. It's not on him. It's not on fulfilling what God has called us to do, church. It's not in our own, it's not in his strength and his power. We just read that Simeon, a devout man, that means consecrated, church, consecrated. And it would go on to say, by what? The Spirit. The Spirit led him. It didn't say that Simeon led Simeon, did it? It said the Holy Spirit led Simeon. It was the Holy Spirit that would work, if you will, in Simeon's life, or at least on the periphery, because Jesus had not went to Calvary yet. So the Holy Spirit could not reside into man that was tainted by sin. He could anoint, he could come upon them for a season, but then he would have to depart because the sin debt had not been paid. But Simeon was a devout, consecrated man to God. So God made him a promise. But you're not going to die till you see the Messiah. He'd say, I have seen your salvation. And he would be praising the Lord. Then we read about Anna. This dear sister was well over 100 years old. Now you think about this. She was well over 100 years old. She had went to the temple after her marriage of 7 years because her husband had died. She stayed in that temple night and day for 84 plus years. No doubt she had a chamber that they accommodated her. But what did they do? She would pray. She would fast. She would seek the Lord incessantly. And God rewarded and gave her favor for her consecration, that she would be able to see the Lord Jesus Christ before she perished. She had seen the salvation of the Lord. Just like Simeon, both of them had seen the salvation of the Lord. Church, if you're born again, you've seen the salvation of the Lord too. You see, the Holy Spirit now is living within inside you to re-energize you, to keep you on the right path following Christ, to encourage you in times of distress when the stocking, if you will, may be getting depleted because we're getting our eye off where it should be for a little while. But this message is simple today. Christmas at the cross. You say, oh, Pastor, that was a place of death. Yes, but it was a place of life for you.
Amen.
And me. Do you get that at home on this Christmas Eve of 23? Do you get that? That his birth we celebrate. But I'm telling you, church, if he had stopped there, you and I, we would not be here. Man would have destroyed himself a long time ago. Oh, but he didn't stop there. He did live that spotless life. Not for himself. Love. A beautiful song that you sang. And I don't know how you did it. Love. Over two little shoes for a mama that was about to go home to the Lord. About to go home to Jesus. Oh, the love of a child. We are all children of the Most High God. Amen. This past week, as I get ready to close, I was watching SBN's program, Message of the Cross. And Brother Lauren Larson asked Brother Swaggart to recite something. And they didn't say the title. I thought it was a poem. And I sent you, those of you that received my daily scripture, part of it. You see, but it wasn't a poem. It was a song, or is a song. I'd never heard this song, ever. In all my years being in church, I've never heard this song. And the only thing I knew to go on was a little bit of the words that he had said. I wrote them down. And I'm like, this is too beautiful just to be a poem. So I went on the computer and I began to do research on the words. Or now we know it's lyrics to a song that was written in the 1800s. The name of the song is called, Is Not This the Land of Beulah? Is Not This the Land of Beulah? And I want you to listen to these words very, very carefully. And if you're a child of God this morning, you will love this song. I am dwelling on a mountain where the golden sunlight gleams, or a land whose wondrous beauty far exceeds my fondest dreams, where the air is pure, ethereal, laden with the breath of flowers that are blooming by the fountain neath the Amerithine bower. Is not this the land of Beulah, blessed, blessed land of light, where the flowers bloom forever and the sun is always bright? I can see far down the mountain where I wandered weary years, often hindered in my journey by the ghost of doubt and fears, broken vows and disappointments, thickly scattered all the way. But the Spirit led unerring to the land I hold today. I am drinking at the fountain where I ever would abide, for I have tasted life's pure river and my soul is satisfied. There's no thirst for earthly pleasures, nor adorning rich and gay, for I have found a richer treasure, one that fadeth not away. heavy crosses, nor the burdens hard to bear. For I found this great salvation makes each burden light appear. And I love to follow Jesus, gladly counting all the dross, worldly honors, all forsaking for the glory of the cross. Oh, the cross has wondrous glory. Often I prove this to be true. When I'm in the way so narrow, I can see a pathway through. And how sweetly Jesus whispers, take the cross, thou needest not fear. For I have trod the way before you, and the glory lingers near. What a beautiful, beautiful song, church. That I've never heard. Never heard it. But the lyrics describe every child of God. If you've lived any time on this earth, you see, Satan wants to, as I mentioned last Sunday, have you living in the past. Have you dwelling in the past instead of taking a glance back and realizing, look how far God has brought me. We, the Satan of the world, will try to look how you blown it. And then the regrets and disappointments and the broken vows of yesteryear can come like ghosts upon you, trying to drain your stocking, trying to drain your faith in now and in the future in Him. Church, as the song says, I can see far down the mountain where I wandered weary years, often hindered in my journey by the ghost of doubt and fears, broken vows and disappointments, thickly scattered all the way, but the Spirit led unerring to the land I hold today. God didn't leave you there, did He? The Lord did not leave you there. The Spirit led Anna, led Simeon to see the salvation of the Lord. And God has done that for His church. Amen?
Amen.
He has done that for you. How many times that you have had struggles? You may even have a struggle today. But the Spirit will lead you out. The Spirit will always lead you out if He's indeed leading you. By faith. You say, preacher, what can I fill the Lord's stocking with? Faith. Faith. It may not look good right now, but God has got you on a journey. Sometimes we mess that up and we try to do a detour instead of, I've done that with my GPS. Going out of town. Me and my Google Maps and on my truck, we've had a lot of arguments. I've lost every one. You see, because this, it's got a feminine voice, so I'm, lady, I've been to Beaumont 25 times, I know how to get there. And yet, at times she'll want to reroute me. I know what I'm doing. She kept saying, proceed to the route, proceed to the route, proceed to the route, proceed to the route. I'm on the route. I know how to get there. Been there, done that. But what I didn't know, but she knew, there was a huge accident down there that had me backed up for a couple hours. How many times have you done the same thing in life? How many times? How many? I've got this. I've got this. And all of a sudden, you wake up and you go, uh-oh, maybe I don't. Oh, church, angel that appeared unto Mary, fear not. Over 360 times in the Word of God, it says fear not, almost one for every day of the year. Fear not. The Lord has sought you and He has bought you, and the last thing He wants in His child's life is to fear.
Amen.
When you've got children and they're in your home, storming outside, they would be scared. But you let them know, you're in my home. Say the same thing to his children today. Fear not. You approach God by faith and celebrate Him. All of Him, not just the birthday. We celebrate Christ every day. I have seen the salvation of the Lord. You have seen the salvation of the Lord. Praise the name. If you're born again, you're on that mountain. You're on a mountain. It may not seem like it. 2023 might have not been a good year for you. Financially speaking, domestically speaking, the world's in a mess in 2024. Dare I say, with the election year and a lot of other things, two wars going on, etc., etc., inflation, with the list goes on and on and on. But I'm here to tell you, you're on a mountain because you're a child of the Most High God.
Amen.
No matter what comes your way, I am a child of God, and this Christmas is at the cross for me. Monday's at the cross for me. All throughout the week, all throughout the year, 2024 is going to be a great year because I'm on the mountain with my Lord and Savior.
Amen.
No matter what may come, Job would say, though he slay me, I will trust him. Faith, church. See, you don't have to have a mountain of faith to be on the mountain with him. Lord, my stock is low. There's been a lot of pain. There's been a lot of hurt. Lord, I need a fresh touch from you. I need you, oh God, to hold your child, to hold me. All it takes is to say, Lord, help me. You see what we preached on last week about loving. Solomon loved the Lord. Solomon loved the Lord. He knows your heart. He knows your heart. The thoughts and intents of the heart, God knows. He knows everything about us. And as we go through life day after day after day, He's got you.
Amen.
If He can keep this world turning on its axis, if that sun can still come up in the east and set in the west, you know something about that? It's every 24 hours, isn't it? You see, our God is an all-time God.
Amen.
You think about that. How could you set your calendar? You can set your calendar because He's faithful.
Amen.
When He sets something in motion, it's done right, and you can bank on it, so to speak. My God is faithful.
Amen.
As we go to prayer, if you need prayer, come on down here. Those of you at home, this year, this Christmas, our prayer is that you draw closer to the Lord and allow Him to fill your stocking. And allow, when you allow Him, when you seek Him for the provision at the cross, and that's the only place you're going to get your stocking filled, is at the cross of Christ. And when He begins to fill you, church, you are giving Him what? Faith. Faith, that's all Jesus asked for. That's all the Heavenly Father asked for. It's simple, childlike faith. And watch Him fill your stocking this morning. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Father, we thank you today for your blessings. Church, sing it.
Silent.
See, Jesus would say on the Sermon on the Mount, you hear me quote the scripture often. Matthew 6 and 33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. All these things. In other words, what, preacher? All the things you need. Not what you think you need, what he knows you need. You see, sometimes there's a world of a difference between the two. But I put my trust and my faith in my Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. Those of you at home, we sincerely wish you a merry, merry Christmas, you and your family. May God richly bless you. Keep Jesus first. Keep Christ in Christmas. Keep your heart at the cross in the Holy Spirit, just like he led Simeon and Anna. He will lead you. May God bless.